Okay, so we'll proceed. We'll just have a recap of dictionaries, and then we'll look at some more methods in dictionaries. And if time permits, we'll take up functions today. We'll look at what a function is, how to write user-defined functions. But we'll take some exercises on dictionaries. Dictionaries, they are going to ask you a lot of questions because another important concept. So what are dictionaries? What this data type is all about? When I say dictionary, what comes to your mind? You should tell me something. What comes to your mind when I say a dictionary? I mean dictionary in Python. You should remember this, right? It consists of a key value pair. You have a key and a value. So that is the concept behind dictionaries. Dictionaries are mutable. What do you mean by mutable? You can add elements to a dictionary. You can delete key value pairs from a dictionary. When I say element, it is nothing but key value pairs. So we'll directly go to the definition. We have seen all these things in the last class. Just a recap. Key value pairs, key should be unique. I can't have two keys with the same name. And dictionaries are mutable. We were looking at keys, right? Can keys be mutable in a dictionary? Can we have mutable keys in a dictionary? Can list be a key? Can set be a key? List and set cannot be keys. We cannot have mutable items to be keys in our dictionary. See, these things you have seen in the last class. I hope you have taken some notes and you're able to refer to that. So that's how a dictionary is. You have a key here, you have a value here, a key and a value, a key and a value. Okay, key should be unique. So how to, if you have multiple keys, this slide is on adding value, key value pairs to the dictionary. How will you add key and value pairs? Like this. You give the dictionary name, you give the key name is equal to the value name. So if I have the keys to be the same, what will happen? The latest value will be updated for that particular key. These things was done in the last class, just a recap. And how you print dictionaries, you print and using the dictionary name, you can print all the key value pairs. You can also use the methods. Dot keys will print only the keys, dot values will print only the values. Whereas there's one more thing we learned, right? DI dot items. When I go with items, it's going to print the entire key value pair, but each key value pair will be printed as a tuple inside a list. So we'll come to DI dot items, I mean dot items function soon. And the keys must be immutable. You cannot have mutable keys. Say a tuple can be a key, but a list and a set cannot be a key because these are mutable items. So we have seen some examples for that too. Clearing all elements, popping an element. See, a dictionary is an unordered set. It doesn't have an indexing. You know, you can't go with indexing for dictionaries, and it only uses the key to traverse and get you the value. So when you pop an item, it will be popping any arbitrary item from the key value pair. So you will get any one item pop. Iterating over a dictionary. Did we go through this in the last class? How do you iterate? I want to print all the elements in the dictionary. So for item in dictionary name, this will go through every key. So item will take all the key values, all the keys. And then I'm going to print key. It's a string concatenation operator. DI of key will print the value for each key. So I think we have gone through this in the last class. So that's how you iterate over a dictionary. You can also iterate using keys and values. So you know di.keys will fetch you only keys. So for item in di.keys will just let you iterate over the keys. Whereas di.values will say, you see here, for item in di.values will fetch only the values. So you can work only on the values of a dictionary. So these are like iterating. Now we'll come to this dictionary methods. We'll see all these methods, how they work with the dictionary now. You can parallelly code with me, not an issue, but try to follow things. It's all easy. So dot length, dot string, and dot clear, dot copy. We'll see all these things. Let's start coding here. So let's create a dictionary. How will you create a dictionary? It's like you give this flower brackets and then curly brackets, and then you'll have some. They will take this example wherein I add my course and what course I'm teaching, right? So you create a dictionary like this, Satish, Python, and Ramesh, and then physics, something like this. You have two elements in this dictionary. And then what we are going to do here is we are going to find the length of the dictionary. It's just the same way, print len of di, that will be an output of 2 because you have two key value pairs in the dictionary. So you have one key value pair, Satish and Python, Ramesh and physics is the another key value pair. So length is 2. Is this clear? So it's a simple length function that we have used already. The next function we are going to learn is we are going to learn about string. You can convert a dictionary to a string and use it. How to convert a dictionary to a string? I will show you that method. It's nothing but di dot underscore underscore str. So you can convert a dictionary to a string and you can assign it as a string. K is equal to di dot underscore underscore str. And then when I go and print k, now k is a string. It's not a dictionary anymore. So let me go and print k. You see here, what you're seeing here is in the form of a dictionary, but it is a string. I can do some slicing here. If I slice the first three elements, that is starting from 0 to 3, what will be the output if I do string slicing here? So it's, say, it slices it as a string. It's no more a dictionary. So you convert a dictionary to a string, and you want to extract anything, you want to do perform anything, you can use this particular method. Dot underscore underscore str underscore that method. Okay. Dot clear we have already seen, right? Di dot clear will remove all the elements, but the dictionary will remain. Dot clear we have already used it for many things. Dot copy. So what is shallow copy? What are the two types of copy we have learned? Shallow and deep copy. Who can tell me the difference? What is shallow copy? What is deep copy? Why we go in for shallow copy and why we go in for deep copy? What happens if you don't use shallow copy? We just use the assignment operator L1 equal to L2. Any changes you make to L2 will affect the original list L1. So original item L1 gets affected. In shallow copy, we use the method copy.copy. In deep copy, we use the method copy.deepcopy. Please refer to my previous lecture to learn more about this. It's a very important concept. So here we can perform shallow copy of dictionary. So it supports only shallow copy. So we'll see what is that. Say I have another dictionary D2. And I want to copy all the elements in DI to D2. I should do DI dot copy. And then I'll print D2. So I'm copying one dictionary to another dictionary. And say if I print D2, what is the output here? Satish Python, Ramesh Physics. So everything in DI got copied to D2, but it's a shallow copy. In the sense, any changes if I make to D2, if I delete D2 of 0, what will be the output for D2 now? Print D2. So you will delete one element from D2, right? Oh, it's not D2 of 0. You should always work with the keys. So that is, let me delete Satish from D2. So if I delete Satish from D2 and print it, what happens? D2 will have only one element, Ramesh and physics. Okay. So we copied DI to D2. So initially D2 was this. Later on, we deleted one element from D2, so Ramesh and physics. Is it going to affect the DI, the original dictionary? Will it affect that? So print DI. Since it's a shallow copy, it will not affect the original dictionary. You see, DI is not affected. But then you have a list to be a key inside this dictionary. I mean, if you have a list to be a value inside this dictionary, and if you change the value for that list, that will change the original list too, because you have to have deep copy for that. But dot copy supports only shallow copy. So if you're still confused about this, go through my previous lecture on shallow copy and deep copy. Then you'll understand that. Here, what is happening? Dot copy, this particular dictionary method, dot copy supports shallow copy. We have one more thing, dot from keys. So you can create a dictionary from by using a key specified in another data type. So let me show you things like how to create a dictionary with use keys from sequence. So we'll take an example directly. Say I have a list of all names here. So I have a list of all names. Say I love my name Ramesh, Ram, and then Sam. So we have a list of all names. And then can I create a key? Can I create a dictionary using the names here to be the keys? I can do that. So I have to first declare a dictionary. And then I should have another dictionary. It's important we do these processes. We say D2 is equal to DI dot from keys. And then you're going to pass L. So it's going to take every element in L, create a dictionary D2. And then D2 will have the keys to be Satish, Ram, and Sam. So when I print D2, you see, it's creating a dictionary by using the elements here in this list. So Satish is the first element, whereas values will be none. So it takes dot from keys will actually create a dictionary. So you should call, say this is like DI dot from keys. DI should also be a dictionary, and D2 should also be a dictionary. That is important. Yes. DI is like a constructor. See, actually, the thing here is instead of using DI, we can call the constructor DICT like this. But DICT is nothing but a constructor. It's coming under object-oriented programming. So when I call this, this will again work. DICT is a default constructor. But students will ask me what a constructor is. So to avoid that, what I told you is you create another dictionary. No problem. No harm in that. So you use that dictionary here. So it's just going to create a dictionary using the list of elements you are going to give. And suppose I want to populate some values also. You can do that. Say I want to give everywhere values to be, one value can be populated for all the keys. Say I want to give values to be, say, test. For all the keys, I want values to be test. I can populate keys L, comma values. Now when I go and print the dictionary out, it will populate Satish test, Ram test, Sam test. So it creates a dictionary using the list L and also the values I have given. So dot from keys is used for this. No, we can only append one value of the same type to all the elements. That's what is supported. For this method, we can have different keys, but value will be one value that is stacked. And value is an optional argument there. Dot from keys, if I don't give values, it will still create the dictionary, right? So values is optional. So if you want to add some any test values while you're creating the dictionary, you can give them. And dot items, a very interesting thing. We have already seen that in the last class, right? Before that, we have dot get to. What is dot get? I will see that. We'll see this function dot get. What dot get does? So it's like we'll create this dictionary again. So I'll be creating this dictionary. So let me check whether that my previous dictionary is still alive. I've got. It's like going to take. So we'll create a dictionary. So it's like I'll have my name on the course I'm teaching. And then we'll have Ram, and then let's say he's teaching physics. So what is di.get is going to perform? So if I'm going to do di.get, and then if I'm going to pass the key, it will just print the value for that key. So it's again going to get the value, di.get method. So if I go and run this, what will be the value? Python will be printed to the user. The same thing like what we did earlier, right? We did something like this, print di, and then we give Satish here. So this will also print the value, right? This will also print the value. But there's a difference between dot get and this one. Say suppose if I comment this this particular line, if I use DI Satish and if I search for something that is not there, SAT, what will happen now? It gives a key error. Whereas DI dot get will not give me a key error. It will return none. DI dot get, if I give SAT, it will not give an error. It will return none. So that is the difference between dot get and dot that you directly give the key and run your code. So when you directly give the key, if it's not available, it will throw an error. It will stop your program, right? It's throwing an error. Whereas when you don't want to throw any errors, if the value is not present in the dictionary, use di.get. So you can very well say, you know, you can very well come out if somebody gives an input and you don't find it, if di.get sat. So if this is like none, it will print. If their value is there, you can say you're welcome, something like that, some message I'm giving. If the value is not there, if that returns a none, none means zero, right? In Python, anything that is zero or none, the value is expression is zero. So we'll say else print value does not exist in dictionary. So you can use it like this. So somebody wants to search, he enters some value, you are doing di.get, and then you're going to run this, value does not exist. It's not going to crash your system with the key error. That's the use of di.get. So dot get method we have seen. And dot items, what is dot items going to return in it from a dictionary? So I'm going to have a di.get here. What is dot items going to do for me? So print di.items. So let's take a look at this. See, it's going to convert every key value pair to a tuple here. So this is a tuple, and whatever you see here, RAM and physics is actually a tuple which is inside a list. So key value pair becomes a tuple. So you want to read that value, key and value from the tuple. How can you do this? Is you can run a for loop for, say, since I am having a tuple, I can give x comma y in di dot items. Print x comma y. Just print x comma y. So what happens is, what di items returns, it will fetch Satish, it will move to x. It will fetch Python, it will move to y. Likewise, it will fetch RAM, it will move to x. Fetch physics, it will move to y. Got it? So if I print this, Satish Python RAM physics. So you can use di.items to retrieve tuple by tuple and then assign it to two values x and y and then print those values independently. We have seen this function dot keys, right? What is dot keys? Returns all the keys. Di.keys gives you all the keys. And what is values? Di.values gives you all the values in the dictionary. Dot set default. This is another interesting function. We'll see what is dot set default. So di dot set default, and then I'm going to say okay, we'll do a print of this. So let me explain you what is dot set default is going to do. Is sat in part of the dictionary? Sat is not a key in the dictionary, right? So it will come and search for sat. If sat, that key is not available, it will display the default message you have set. So the user searches for a value and he wants to get some message back, right? So you can very well say no such key. If I put this, say if the user enters SAT and you are going to do di.set default and then you're going to run this, you'll get this no such key. So it's going to search. If it's not available, it will return no such key. Okay. But I just want to do this. What if it's available? I didn't check that. Should it return the value? Yeah. So if it's available, it returns the value. If it's not available, it sends you the default message you're going to give. No such key. Very effective. We'll be using these things in an exercise soon. Dot update. So you can add a dictionary to another dictionary. That's possible. You can add another dictionary. If I have another dictionary di2, if I have some two values here, test1 and test2, test1 colon, the value to be test value. If I want to add this dictionary to my dictionary di, if I want to add that, what I can do is I can do di.update di2. So this will take this dictionary, add it here, and then when I print di, you see here both these dictionaries are merged together. Now you have test1 test value added to your dictionary. So you can take an entire dictionary and just update your another dictionary. So many methods are supported by dictionaries. That's why they always focus on dictionaries more in the examinations. So is this clear, all these things? So I told you dictionary is shallow copy, right? Di1.copy is a shallow copy. What do you mean by shallow copy? It works fine for you know, as long as you don't have any inner lists or any other references from within your dictionary. So can anyone explain me this code on the board? Can you tell me, can you prove that it supports only shallow copy by just reading the code and explaining it? Someone, can you come and take this role now? What this code is all about, and why you say it's an example for shallow copy? I give you an opportunity. Please come and explain this code. It consists of two dictionary items, and one dictionary is getting copied to another dictionary. And then the next dictionary, I am changing. I think I can even delete this. Yours, if you are very confused, let me delete this one part. We can have this to be an empty dictionary. No need to really have some contents here. Really, you are confused. This one. Now let's save and run. Yeah, this one. Now can you explain why I say it's shallow copy? Dot copy is a shallow copy method. So let me explain it here. We have already seen this, but still a refresher. Say for instance, I have this dictionary di1. It contains all these elements. See, one of the keys is a list. This is a list of values. So you have a key. How many values you have? Three values stacked to a key. That is possible. A key cannot be a list, but a value can be a list. So what happens here? I'm trying to copy di1 to di2. So the, all the elements here will be copied to di2. When I use dot copy method, it's a shallow copy, right? And what I'm trying to do here is di2, Satish and 0. What happens? It goes to this particular key. What does element 0 refer to? 123. So I'm changing 123 to 125. In di2, in dictionary 2. Now after changing that, I am printing di1. What is di1? You see di1 is also changed to 125. That's because it's a shallow copy, not a deep copy. When you have some references within your object, the same thing is getting copied here. The references are getting copied. So that's why we say dot copy method is shallow copy. So to have a better understanding of what shallow and deep copy is, you should have revisited the concepts. So dot from keys we have seen with an example. All these things we have seen. Dot get method also we have seen how it's different from the normal way. Dot items we have seen how to read key value pairs and print. Set default we have seen. If the key is not available, it will print a default message. If the key is available, it print the value. Dot update, copy one dictionary and update another dictionary. Is this all fine? Now we'll move to dictionary comprehension. What is list comprehension? Because in dictionaries we have a comprehension too. List comprehension is you write, you can create a list using one line of code. Easier way of creating lists. Likewise, you can also create dictionaries using dictionary comprehension. So here, what I am giving you an example here, say I have one dictionary which has got some values here. That is, key is num1, value is 3, number 2 is 4, number 3 is 5. I want to create another dictionary using dictionary comprehension method such that all the values here are only even odd numbers. So DI2 should contain only num1, 3 and num3, 5. Num2, 4 should be skipped. So creating a dictionary from another dictionary in one line using dictionary comprehension. So if you have gone through my list comprehension, this will be very, very easy. How you create a dictionary comprehension? Let's try this one out. Let me show you a demo of this alone. So we have some numbers there, right? So we have num1. Number 1 is, say it's 3, right? Number 1 is 3 and number 2 is, the value for number 2 is 4. And number 3 is, the value for number 3 is 5. Now I should create another dictionary that contains only odd numbers using dictionary comprehension. So for that, how can you create that is, we give D2 is equal to, and you should have some number here, right? That one we have to have, and then we should also have a key. So how can you do this? Can you come out with the code? See, this actually uses the concept of DI items dot items. What DI dot items does is it retrieves both key and value as a tuple, right? So what I have given there is I retrieve the key and value and just populate it as V colon R. For V R in DI dot items. And then I also have an if condition, if R mod 2 not equal to 0. So you retrieve the key value pair and then you do this check, the check. So let's go and perform this. Say these are two variables, V colon R. What is V colon R is? For V comma R. So that's a tuple from in DI. For V comma R in DI dot items. We have to give this because only then it will return it as a tuple. And then we have to check if, what we have to check? R, right? R corresponds to this value. So R corresponds to the value. So we have to check whether R mod 2 not equal to 0. So what is V? V is nothing but num1, num2, num3. So it retrieves V and R, right? So V will be running from num1, num2, num3. R will be taking the values 3, 4 and 5. So if R mod 2 not equal to 0, in the sense if R is odd, then you are going to have that in this dictionary. So if you are going to run this print D2, we see whether this is working. So you are going to have only odd numbers from that dictionary populated here using dictionary comprehension. So we have done all these things in list comprehension, right? Two-dimensional list, how will you create using list comprehension? We have seen very tough exercises. So this should be easy. Only thing is, how will you get the key value pair? You have to retrieve the key and value and move it to another dictionary. Because the dictionary contains key and value. Please understand that. I can't just put R there. R will be just one value. A dictionary should contain key and a value, or else it's not a dictionary. So that's one good example. I'll give you another exercise which you can try. Let's try this one. Okay. Consider the list given below. 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Create a dictionary using the list L such that the output is like this. So it should take every number from there and it should say even, 4 is even, 5 is odd, 6 is even. If it is even, it should say even. If it is odd, it should say odd. So you have to take that list, create a dictionary out of that. For every number, you have to check whether it is even or odd and you have to populate that in that dictionary. Can you try that? Using dictionary comprehension, just one line you have to do. See, it's very similar like what we did for list comprehension. Populate only even numbers to the list from a two-dimensional list, right? We nullified all the other numbers in that two-dimensional list. Likewise, you have to perform this. Take every element there and then what you have to do is you have to check whether it is odd or even and then you have to populate that to a dictionary. That's one good exercise for dictionary comprehension. We'll also try that. So we have some list there, right? We have some list. What are the numbers we had in that list? 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So, okay. It's a list. 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. So, I have to create a dictionary now. Well, it's an empty dictionary, right? I can create a dictionary. So, it should be I for I in L. So, if I give this comprehension, every element in L will be added to this dictionary. But then dictionary should have a key value pair. So, how can you have a key and a value? So, I can give something like this, I colon. I can say it's odd if I mod 2 not equal to 0. Else, I can say even. That's it. So, I give I. What will be I? I will be 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So, it will check if I mod 2 not equal to 0, it will print that to be odd. Else, it will print that to be even. Let's check whether my comprehension really works here. Print di. So, let's perform this. Yeah. So, you can use if-else conditions in your list comprehension. Likewise, in your dictionary comprehension also you can use. You can use multiple if-else. If you can give. Three if conditions you can give. Nested if. We also seen how to use nested for loops inside list comprehension, right? So, this one is a good example for how to create a dictionary by just traversing every element and then using a decision and giving some values for that element. Very interesting example. Were you able to understand this? So, I will take all the values. What is I? I will range for I in the loop. When you take a look at the loop here, for I in L. So, I will take every value in L. So, it will start from 2, 4, 5, 6. Every time we are checking if I mod 2 not equal to 0. If it is not equal to 0, odd will be added. Else, even will be added. It will be added after this column. So, dictionary comprehension is also possible. And we have seen some good examples here. So, if you are not able to execute it, don't, no problem, you know, I will share the lectures, you can try it later on, but you have to try it. So, another example here. So, what is that I want to give you is, create another dictionary with names that start with capital letters alone. Say, I have a dictionary here, there are some names that start with small letters, some names that start with capital letters. How will you create a dictionary containing names with capital letters alone? Can you? I mean, the name should start with a capital letter. If you remember, we did the same exercise with lists. Who can recreate that here? So, you have a dictionary, you have a name, right? So, you have some name fields there. So, let me go and check that. Name 1, name 2, name 3. So, the values will be Satish, Sam and Ram. So, you should only create another dictionary having the values wherein the name should start with a capital letter. So, how do you do that? So, if I have a name to be starting with a capital letter, I will add it to my output dictionary. So, that should be my output. Name 1 Satish, name 2 Santosh. Whereas Sam is having a, no, the starting letter for Sam is small, lowercase. So, we will not include that. I have given the output on the board. But without looking at the output, can you try things out? It just takes some time, right? So, you need key value pair. Now, you're going to use another dictionary. Let's execute this. Let's say you're going to use another dictionary here. Let's say it's name 1, right? Name 1, and then we'll have name 1 to be Satish, and we'll take two names. Name 2. Name 2 is Ramesh, and then we'll have name 3 too. One small letter, one lowercase we'll have. Name 3 is say that guy Sam is having a small lowercase. So, we should have Ramesh and Satish populated to our another dictionary. So, how we are going to do this is, we are going to say D2 is my next dictionary. And then I am going to populate V colon R, key and value, for, that is the tuple we are going to read, VR in DI dot items. So, we are going to traverse DI dot items, we are going to get every tuple, we are going to move name 1 to V, Satish to R. So, like that, it's going to traverse that dictionary. And then we are going to have a simple if condition. If r 0, so you have to slice, you have to use string slicing inside dictionary comprehension. Everything is related here. So 0 and 1 dot is upper. So only when this condition is satisfied, we are going to use that in our dictionary. Let me print this one, print D2. Yeah, Sam is left out here. Only Satish and Ramesh got added. What's the condition we used here? We retrieve every V and R, key and value from my dictionary. And then what we are checking here is, what is R? R is the value. So R of 0, 1 will slice the first letter. And then it'll check if it is dot is upper. We have used that with list comprehensions too. The same method. Dot is upper. Then we are going to add. If this condition is satisfied, that R value will be added to my dictionary. So you can create good dictionaries by just one line of code. Okay. So is this done? So this one, you know, you should only slice R, because R contains the value. In V comma R, R contains the value. Okay, so let me go to the next thing, nested dictionaries. That is, you can have a dictionary within a dictionary. That is possible. So how you can have nested dictionaries is, I have given an example here. A student can have multiple phone numbers, right? For instance, you can have a mobile number, you can have a landline number. So you see here, student, what is the key? 12BCE001. So this is the key here, and for this key, what is the value? So when you take a look at this, the value itself is another dictionary. It's a dictionary within a dictionary. So in this dictionary, what is the key? Mobile is the key, landline is the key. The value is the number. So you have a dictionary embedded within another dictionary. Like that, you can have multiple nesting, right? You can have another dictionary embedded within this dictionary. So how can you access now, say for one student, mobile number and landline number is given. How can you print the mobile number for this student? Print the mobile number for 12BCE001. How can you do that is, you have to use a print, and then you should give the dictionary name, and then you should give the key. Normally what you do. So the key here is 12BCE0001. Next, after giving the key, I should give this particular key to. That is the index. I mean, I should not say it's an index. I should give this key to. So when I give mobile, what it will do is, it will go to this key, then it will go to mobile, and then it will print the value 99765555222. So that's how you use the square brackets and you give multiple keys. So if I want to print the landline number, what should be the output? It should be DI, and then I should give the key 12BCE0001, and for him I should print the landline number, right? So I should give the landline as the key, landline. If I don't have the key value pairs, if I just have mobile numbers and landline numbers, I say retrieve all the landline numbers for a student. How will you do that? If I don't have key value pairs like this, I just have 99995220416222200. I say retrieve all the landline numbers for every student. How will you do that? For loop, but how will you know whether it's a landline number or a phone number, mobile number? You have to use regular expressions within dictionaries. So you should match the pattern of landline number, triple twos, and those four digits. You should write a regular expression, retrieve that from the, you use di.items, retrieve every value, check if it matches with the pattern. If it matches with the pattern, and then you have to say, these are the landline numbers. You see here, that's about our nested dictionaries. You're able to understand that, right? Now, if I want to have for two students, mobile numbers and landline numbers, how my dictionary changes. You see here, this is the key. This entire thing is the value for this key. whereas we have a key here, key here. So it's a nested set of dictionaries for every student. Maintain landline number and phone numbers. So you can maintain entire student record here. His parent name, his address. So everything becomes a key value, right? Address, parent, everything. So you can maintain entire record within your dictionary. So I don't know, you will be learning Mongo database somewhere later on. So that database maintains such key. You have a key, you have a value. That's it. You populate the text directly into the DB. So while you retrieve that data back, you'll be retrieving the key and then you'll be getting the data. So this is again, you know, how can you print any number of 12BC002? You just give the key and then you say mobile, it'll print the mobile number for that student. So you have to use the key. I put registration number to be the key because registration number is unique for every student. So printing mobile number for a student, that's what I told you, use the keys and you display. Yeah, now we can have an exercise that you are going to perform. And we'll see this exercise before going into this. Say dictionaries are unordered set. You don't have any indexing for dictionary. So how will you sort a dictionary? For instance, I have here 222, 555, 333, 111. Unordered, say it's not in the any order, right? But I expect an output to be like this. 111, 222, 333, 555. You have to sort the dictionary, but you don't have any methods for that. How will you do this? Can you try this one? That's your exercise now. Once when you are done with this, the next exercise that we are going to have is read country and capital names for n number of countries the user wants to give. When the user wants to search for a country, display the capital name for that country. If that country name is not there in your dictionary, say no such country name available in dictionary to the user. Got it? For n countries, read the country and capital name. Whenever the user searches for a country, display the capital name. If that country name is not available, say no such country name in the dictionary. These two exercises you have to complete now. So let me try this program wherein I read in country names for n countries and then store the capital names and display the capital name when a country name is given as an input. So for this, I should get number of countries from the user, right? Num countries. So int input, enter countries. Enter num countries. And then what we can do next is for these countries, you know, the user should enter, for I in range num countries. So for those many countries, what we have to do, we have to get the country name from the user. Country name is equal to, it's a string, right? So it's input. So we'll say enter country name. So we should enter country name. Likewise, you should also enter capital name. It's a string, both are strings, so enter capital name. That's it. So he is going to enter country name and capital name. Every time he enters, I should populate that to a dictionary. So I will have a dictionary, DI, it's an empty dictionary. How will I populate that? DI of country name is equal to capital name. That's it. So it's going to create a dictionary and it's going to populate that. And now we'll see whether this one works. I'll just go step by step always when I code. So print DI. That's it. Let's check whether this one works. Enter number of countries. Say I want to have two countries. And we'll say enter country name. Country name will enter India. And then capital name will say New Delhi. And then country name US. And then capital name Washington. So we enter two countries, right? Now when I print, the dictionary is created. Now for any number of countries, the dictionary will be created because it's inside a for loop. Now what I should do is I should say, given search, let search be the country the user wants to search. So input, I'll say enter search country. So he wants to search for some country. And now what we have to do is we have to find this country in my dictionary. How can you do that? We can do print di dot set default and then I can give search the parameter search here. If that is not available, I can give no such country. That's it. So we'll try whether this one works. Let me enter the number of countries again. Countries will be 2. Let's again create India and New Delhi will have, and then we'll have US and Washington. Now enter the search countries. I want to search for India, New Delhi. So if I'm going to give something that is not there, how will I, we should also check for the other test cases, right? If the country is not available. So India and New Delhi, we'll just go with this and then US and Washington. So if I give UK, no such country. See how effective this dot set default function is. So that's what I was telling you. It finishes the entire search and gives the default message in one line. The effective, that's why Python is really effective with libraries. No if else, nothing, you know, you just finish it in one line. That's why I'm telling you, for C programmers, switch over to Python. You accept Python, then you will be happy. If you live with C, you will write lot of code, and for this you'll be writing lot of if else, searching through a thing, and but this one works. It's not a complicated piece of code. This function, you see the use of this particular function dot set default, it'll search for that value. If it's not present, it'll give this message. Is this clear for all of you? There's one more program, right? That is like sorting the list. Did you finish that? Sorting the dictionary. Did you all finish that? Let me try that one too. So we have a dictionary there. We have 1 and 11. See, when you don't have strings, you should never give that in quotes. In 3 and 33, and then we had some. It was not in the sorted order. So we should look at the values there. 222, 111 was at the last. Something like this. 222, 111. And then what else you add? 555. So it's not in the sorted order, right? So how to sort this? For this, what I can do is I can create a list, and then I can do extract all the keys out to my list. So now I can do L dot sort. That should sort my list, right? So let me create a list, an empty list. And then I do this L dot sort. I think it should work. It's not working. I will move this sorted keys to a list. Sort keys to be sorted of L, something like that. I'm just sorting my list because list can be sorted, right? Now, for item in sort key, that is sorted key, what I'm going to do is I'm going through every item in my sorted list. And then I'm going to just do print. I just print and show you. You can have this item. That is the key. We have already gone through this, right? Then we'll have, since it's all integers, I'll convert that to, concatenate that to string, because I'm going to use some concatenation here. And then string, and then now what is this item? Item is a key. Now I can directly use it in my dictionary and then populate the item. So it'll tag that. Now let's go and check whether this is in the sorted order. So you see here, so we can also have this end operator. End is equal to the same line I'll print for you. So you see it's sorted. So you should just take the methods, take the keys, sort it, iterate through the key list. So it's a key, right? So directly I can use di of key. That's it. It'll put the key di of key. I have given this logic in my previous class, how to iterate through every item and print the item and the value for that item. So that's, now you have even strings there. It's going to take, sort these strings. Now for every string, what value, it will print it out. Please go through this, check if it's fine. There can be better logic other than this too, but as far as I was thinking just before the class, I was able to get this. So if you find something better, it's fine. sorting a dictionary. So you have to, that's what we said, you know, you have to convert something to a list, list to a tuple, tuple to a set. You should try and see which one will work. You have to think before programming. What's the best way to do this? First think about that. Okay, I'll do this. You have a map, you have the algorithm in mind. Then you start coding. I want to sort it somehow. So I was thinking, okay, let me get the keys, move it to a list, sort it. Where sort is available, there I'm going to move my data. Sort it. Now for every sorted key, print the key and the item.